reason for the calling, as you'll be aware, this report was actually produced for the same part of a, it says, reimagining leisure and cultural services, which included libraries. And we were conscious that there'd been a previous consultation that had taken place around libraries, and no outcome from that report had been received or was even considered, from what I can tell, when the decision taker was looking at this particular decision. Even though, following on from our call in discussions with our solicitor, it appeared as though this report was available, had been looked at, and was actually produced in January 2017, and yet it hadn't been released to other members or even the public. The other issue I had, and the signatories had, was that our idea of consultation is not taking a decision and telling everyone about it, but it is actually to involve and engage people in that whole process. And sadly, it struck us that none of that had taken place, and what we were left with was with a decision, a report that had been produced by Bates, Wells, and Braithwaite, but had actually, it was setting the agenda and the strategic direction. And then the cabinet member had said that she wanted to go from that strategic outline business case to the production of a full business case. And if we were just to look at what this actually says, in the actual document itself that we are asking to go through a full business case, it's saying they were recommending an alternative delivery model and not continued in-house provision. It talked about two possible structures. It goes on, as I say, you then have the whole element of friends groups who who didn't have any opportunity to involve themselves. And in fact, I think one of the key things was picked up by Pat Cleary, who had said that he had asked for information, been told that information was available, but he consistently requested that data be shared in order to scrutinise figures, allow the trade unions to give a view on any proposal, whether in infancy or not. And he said that hadn't happened, and he'd got it very late. Also, that the timetable was optimistic, in that it seemed that it was already a done deal. Equally, that is the impression that friends groups have seen. No doubt you'll hear about that this evening, and also library groups, that the council is acting as a megaphone, as opposed to actually listening to what people have to say. We go on, and again, I think in the recommendations of the report of January, where it actually talks about reducing controllable budget by 20%, it talks about closing 10 libraries. And then it goes on to talk about mobilising friends and volunteer groups. Well, Mike's volunteer, and no doubt will share his insights around this. But it strikes me that if we are, as a council, are actually going to mobilise and engage volunteers and people to support some of these services, the best way of doing that is to engage with them at the outset, listen to what people have got to say, and then respond, and come back and speak to them, say, we've listened to you, this is the report that we're looking to produce, have we covered all the options? Because, and then take you forward, so at least the cabinet would have been informed, would have had an insight into what people felt about those proposals. And I think one of the other elements that I find disappointing is oftentimes if you actually speak to people at the coalface, either the users or the people who are working in these various services, there will be ideas and suggestions about how the service can be improved and how we can make better use of the resources that we currently deploy and actually improve the whole experience for actually going to miss the point, as it strikes me. If the Cabinet is going to move forward on these proposals, they should actually ensure that proper engagement, proper consultation takes place, and that people listen, don't just listen, but respond as well. It's all very easy to go, well, off those meetings and you listen, but did you respond to what I heard? So that's why this has been called in. We think the Cabinet, the decision maker, has missed the trick, and proper consultation hasn't been carried out at the outset, and that doesn't bode well for any further consultation as you go into the full business.
Thank you, Councillor. Do we have any questions from the members, Councillor?
Thanks, Chair. Chair, I am a little bit confused about this call tonight. The Council did a review in January. I met the people who came up to do the review, and may I say, this report, I've read it now three times, and I think it's an excellent report. It's very balanced.
Which report are you talking about?
The report on the libraries.
Oh, the one that says produced by 20%.
Well, I'm not going to comment on that. You said before I might make some comments.
Yeah.
I was involved with the review, Chair, on three separate occasions. Along with I was involved with the consultation as a member of the volunteer group in Bensley Library. I was at another meeting which was the Library Forum, which was a big meeting.
We have a question.
Yeah, there is a question here. My initial question was, I'm a bit confused about the call. And some of the things, and I'd like to challenge some of the things you said, Jeff. But the main thing about tonight is, there's no decisions being made on anything. It's still a work in progress. As you know yourself, Jeff, within the council, but the documents being produced on the libraries, and there's other consultations going on within the leisure services. But yeah, I just wanted to state, I was a bit confused about why the calling was made in the first place at this stage. Thank you, Chair.
You want me to answer? And again, the reason it was called over, maybe I didn't explain myself properly. Clearly, I didn't. I'm sure that's a fault on my part, not yours, for listening. In terms of the point I was trying to make, was what the Minister of Cabinet says was that this was a bit agreed, that we accept the report, and that we move from here to full business case with a degree of speed. And what I was saying is, I think the proper consultation was to do it up front, and I'm not quite clear, given the speed that we're talking about, that consultation is going to be done in between, and that we'll get a full business case where the authority will tell people what's been decided, rather than allow people to actually engage with the process and perhaps come up with something better. That's the point.
This question I've been asked of the Cabinet and their witness. I'll ask you, Jeff, the same question. Do you agree that, given the financial constraints of the Council, that we must look at different ways of services and fee as an option? And can you inform the Committee, and therefore the public, the actual level of savings needed over the next 3 years as a result of government cuts and removal of our SG?
Well, the issue for me that, Chairman, is I've been told by the Borough Solicitor that I couldn't argue on the basis that it was a wrong decision, because we're not allowed to do that. That's in the purview of the Cabinet. All we could do was say that the Cabinet took the wrong, wasn't fully informed of all the information, and therefore didn't take the right decision. But I am aware that clearly the Council has to make statements, and yes, I do believe alternative delivery methods will be required. But I think, from my experience in change, because I've done that and do that professionally, the best way of achieving change is engaging with people right through the entire journey. So you engage with people, you explain what the issues are, you involve them in those discussions, and that you take them with you to see what new possibilities are available. Simply telling people, we're not doing that anymore, we're going to do this, doesn't engage or involve people in the process, and you don't get very good decisions.
And the second one was the BWB people meeting on one other person. So I'm not quite convinced on how much of a consultation was done with the public, to be fair. I know it's difficult when you put these out there and people don't turn up. How to make them turn up? But again, that's one thing. With regards to talking about, I mean, this is more than just the libraries, but with regards to the libraries, we've been discussing the libraries now for years. We were talking about getting what we were to provide as a council, as a library service. I don't think this tells us that at all. We still haven't got a definition of what we are going to provide in library services. And looking at this report, which is quite comprehensive, a lot of it is down to people, you know, heads per library regarding our neighbours, whether we've got 13,000 per library or 13, or they've got 14,000. But nothing actually tells us about what we actually have or what we're trying to achieve here in the borough of Wirral for our residents. So although it's a very nice and thick thing, and I've read it twice, I couldn't do it three times, it doesn't tell me what I want to know about libraries and what we're to provide as a service for our libraries.
And in response to those two questions, which I'm going to give you two
The
question is, why does this not tell us what it is we're supposed to be providing as a library service, which is what the first one that we didn't get in January was supposed to have done? The first report that only got half done and not given to us because it wasn't completed.
The other question was around consultation. It should be, as we know, we have a very vibrant friends groups for parks. We have very vibrant library groups. It wouldn't have taken beyond the wit of people to actually go out and visit the libraries and the library groups and the friends groups to ask questions. Equally, if I might publish it, Tracy will know she did this professionally in terms of consultation. Just sticking something up on the internet and saying it was there, you should, if you didn't click on it and read it, it's your own fault. Actually, there's sometimes when you engage with some of these groups, you have to physically go out and engage with them and not be passive in terms of it was on, you know, page 77 of the intranet that you could have gone over and looked at it if you really wanted. So there's something about physically seeking and being proactive about consultation. And if you do that, the chances are, in my view, you're more likely to get a better decision. I'm sure on previous occasions when we tried to when the council tried to downsize library service, if some of that work had gone on, at least some of the potential consequences would have been known, as opposed to the unknown consequences that then blew up in the council's favour.
Okay, thanks very much. Any more questions?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'd like to ask Councillor Green, because three of the comments you made, because I made notes of them. One, you said that the council was not listening to people.
Oh.
You referred to the council closing 10 libraries, and you said that there was no proper consultation. And my question, Chair, through you to Councillor Green is, do you believe that decisions have already been made on these issues and that there will be no further consultation? That's basically my question.
I think that has to be the suspicion, and I think that has to be the suspicion for groups that are, I can tell you, some of the people I speak to, that is the way they feel the council operates. And that's why I've suggested here that the council needs to pause and make sure it does do that heavy lifting at the outset. If people put in the work at the beginning with engaging with people and listening to people and responding to what they're telling them, then the chances are you're going to get a better solution at the end. The issue for us, I think, is people have
administration to follow now?
I try and avoid, a bit like former mayors really, I try and avoid saying my day was like this or it's like that.
But what we actually, straightforward question.
Okay, I'll explain that. What we did was we actually invited groups of people like users, service users and so on, and experts in the area, and other respected figures, the chair, to become part of a task force. They went away and looked at all the data, so they had contact with a range of people. They then produced a set of proposals, which then were widely consulted on. Not only did we use the internet in terms of getting people's responses, but we also sent out the council engagement team to work with people at various sites to talk about some of the issues. We even, as Councillor Lewis would tell, we actually used groups that would knock on doors in part to reach groups to get their views. We made every possible effort to go out and get everybody's views. Once we had those views, we then came together and looked at those, looked at possible options. And I have to say, in a number of areas, the recommendations were adjusted and led by that entire process. And in my opinion, we came up with one of the most, the widest range of consultation exercises council has seen. And we saved considerable sums of money without the dislocation that I think poor consultation on this basis actually leads to. You did ask me.
Okay, thanks, Chair. I would just like to, in my submission, just try to kind of present some key points, really, and try and address some of the many, I think, red herrings that we've just heard from Councillor Green, who either hasn't read the report or has read it and doesn't understand the report. First of all, just a bit of context. Why are we embarking on this review? We're embarking on this review because of the, as we all know, the swingeing cuts that this authority is facing over the next 4 years. Just to put the figures into the public domain, we know that we've had 156 million of cuts in the council's budget since 2010. Over the next 4 years, we will be making £132 million worth of cuts, which is made up of £45 million this year, £25 million 2018-19, £25 million 2019-20, and £37 million in 2021. And as we all know, that puts us as an authority that prides itself on delivering good quality public services in a very difficult position to continue those vital public services. Now, we've just had a general election where, my view, the clear message from the electorate was they don't want further austerity. Whether the government heeds that view, and as I do hope, changes tack and starts to fund local government properly, remains to be seen. But in the meantime, we've got a budget to balance, and we've got to make sure that we deliver the savings that I've outlined. I hope the government does, maybe we'll get a clue in the Green speech. However, in order to deal with this horrendous challenge that we've got on our budget, we do have to do things differently. So we've got a major plank of the administration's budget is to look at doing things differently, delivering services differently, looking at new models of service delivery. And I won't bore the committee with the work that we've done already in areas like day centres or rural evolutions, the local authority training company, Edcentral, with shared services, with schools, which is a community interest company, and there are a lot of other examples as well. The leisure and cultural services that we're looking at in this review savings we need to make, but continue to offer the public of Wirral good quality public services. And we need to do that because A, this is a, these services are valued by our residents, we know that. It's one of our key pledges to make good quality leisure and cultural services available to all. But we know that we subsidise leisure and cultural services to the tune of £17 million a year. So clearly, in the context of those big numbers I gave at the start, we can't do nothing. You know, we've got to address this issue. So, in order to do that, we commissioned Bates, Wells and Braithwaite, the company that the consultants did this work, to look at how we can deliver good quality leisure, cultural services going forward, but as well, a more efficient service that meets all those objectives I've outlined. Company have got a lot of experience. If people want to look at their track record at looking at these kind of services, and they're a company that believes in what's called the social value model, the importance of protecting local jobs and services, looking at apprenticeships, and ensuring that services are affordable by everybody in the community, particularly people from more deprived communities. So, getting on to the main point of what I wanted to say, you know, the work, it was always understood, and it's been set out in numerous reports. This work will be done in a number of phases. Phase one will be a scoping phase, and the report that went to Cabinet on the 27th of March is the outcome of that scoping exercise. It looked at some possible models of providing this service going forward. Came out with three options, not two options, as Councillor Green claimed. Continue with in-house, a community interest company model, and a charity trust. Those are the three possible options that it looked at. Phase two, which is the next phase, was always the understanding that phase two was the phase in which we do the detailed consultation, right? And that is, if I can just ask members to look at paragraph 8.3, page 15 of the report, and it says, and I quote, it is proposed that further detailed consultation and engagement with a wide range of residents, staff, elected members and other stakeholders is undertaken, as well as formal pre-decision scrutiny by the council's environment over the scrutiny committee will take place as a part of the process for developing a full business case. And paragraph 3.3 of the report talks about building a detailed operation model based on deeper research and a wider engagement with stakeholders. So it was always the case that the detailed consultation was going to take place in phase two. And therefore, my contention in this, in defending this decision, is that the calling is jumping the gun. The detailed consultation will take place, but it will take place in phase two. And the irony of the call-in, Chair, is that it's actually held up the consultation starting. It could have started previously, but you know we are where we are. So it is my view that the things that the call-in are asking for will be delivered in terms of engaging with friends groups, residents, staff, trade unions, etc. But that will be part of phase two. And in that context, I'll finish on this. I want to reiterate that no decisions have been made yet about these services. That will come with the full business case, and there will be ample opportunity for proper engagement and pre-scrutiny consideration from this committee before anything comes back to Cabinet for a final decision. Thank you, Chair. Is you know, you can always do communications better. Obviously, we're going to hear from the head of communications a bit as one of the witnesses tonight, so Ken McCallum will be able to tell you exactly what trade unions. I've always been clear with people that the consultation would be in phase two. But, you know, I would defer to Kevin Callum, who will talk about how the review was kind of launched and what was said to which groups. I think there has, if I could use that, the only point I would add is I think there has been some consultation already with some of the groups that have been mentioned as part of phase one, but I just want to reiterate my point is that the main elements of the consultation was always envisaged to take place in phase two. And certainly, I mean, I've been approached by friends groups as a result of the phase one report being issued. I've made it clear, both in writing and verbally, that there will be opportunity for friends groups who do a fantastic job to input to this study in phase two. So that's my answer. So in my view, it's absolutely essential. Remember, coming from on this, and it's always been the reason why we've done the review, is how can we continue to deliver these services which people treasure, but do it in an affordable way given the huge financial challenge that we face. As I say, I hope the government might reconsider, but I'd like to see the colour of the money first before I change my mind. But in the meantime, we have to work on the basis that these are the savings we need to make to balance the budget in the next 4 years ahead.
Thank you. Councillor
Thanks, Chair. Phil, can I ask you to pick up on technical points in terms of the report and the decision that followed that report? On page 7, the one that is the photograph now from there on the report, it says that the cabinet member for transformation was responsible for this portfolio. Now, clearly, you have a briefing on portfolios and cabinets, but I understand that their portfolios and the scheme of delegations yet to be decided on. Can you tell us which cabinet member has responsibility under your plan for this particular aspect of work?
The cabinet member for transformation has, Councillor Angela Davis has responsible for the overall transformation programme. The cabinet member for delivering differently, Councillor Spriggs, has responsibility for implementing new models of service delivery. So there's a joint responsibility between those two cabinet members.
Okay, thank you. Staying with that, Chair, on the same page 7, the remarks that were made at the cabinet meeting by Unison's branch secretary, that he states specifically that Bates, Wells and Braithwaite consulted with the Labour Group. Is that correct?
We've had a consultation from Jim Clifford,
yeah. The Labour Group?
Yes.
Now, turning to page 8, it makes reference to the possibility that a not-for-profit organisation would be exempt from VAT. Now, clearly, Unison disputed that claim. Can you advise us what advice you received from where that said that not-for-profit would be able to be claimed with that and doing it in-house wouldn't?
There's a debate going on about whether if you are in-house you can claim VAT. The Ealing judgment, or the judgment relating to Ealing, there was a debate going on about whether that is applicable to other authorities as well. We're being advised by our legal team as to what the position is. And my view is that needs to be again tested properly as part of the full business case. So I suppose the point I'm making is there isn't total clarity about whether the hearing judgment can apply to our circumstances as well.
In that case, and that leads on to the next question. If it's still being debated as to whether we could retain services in-house and claim VAT, why have you specifically ruled out keeping the services in-house?
I've just tried to make it clear, Chair, that paragraph 1.3 of the report, when it happened on the 27th of March, highlights three models as being the models that we will look at as we move to the full business case. And in-house provision is one of those three models.
Right.
So that's not going to be the way.
Okay. In that case then, moving on to page 10. Councillor McLaughlin, who's a cabinet member, promised that there would be increased scrutiny work on this decision and should we decide whether a task and finish group was established. At what stage are we for that decision?
I'd refer you to paragraph 8.3 of the report, page 15, which says that, as well as the detailed consultation and engagement which I've just alluded to, there will be formal pre-decision scrutiny by the council, by this committee, as part of the process of developing a full business case. So it is my understanding, and it's obviously a matter for this committee. I don't control this committee, but there will be an opportunity for this committee to consider the full business case before it goes back to cabinet in October.
Right. Chair, one more question from that. Several years ago, Fred, created the post of Strategic Director for Transformation of Resources back in 2013. I think you were quoted in the Global at the time, as you say, that person played a major role in making the council a success that residents, staff, and stakeholders truly deserve. Can you outline what that post or what that person has done in the 4 years since to get us to the position, and why you decided that this
mentioned the business support services, which we've transferred to the Chamber of Commerce, and I could also mention the adult social care function, which is now been transferred to Wirral NHS Community Trust. So I think there's lots of evidence that we've made good progress on the transformation of change in the last 3 or 4 years. This is a really important piece of work because of the scale of the service. I've mentioned 17 million, and also the fact that it's non-statutory. So it's a really big challenge to make a case for maintaining these non-statutory services. But we know that they're valued hugely by the residents of Wirral, so we need to keep them going. Why do we employ consultants? Because, you know, with the best will in the world, we have not got in-house experts on new models of service delivery in leisure and culture. And BWB, again, if you look at their track record, they have lots of experience of looking at arts and cultural and leisure organisations, and from a social value perspective, which I mentioned is important to me personally, because I believe, you know, these services are not just about the bottom line. They are about doing things in a way that provides services which are accessible by the most disadvantaged people in our communities. And BWP have a good track record of advising organisations on those kinds of changes. We do, in my view, possess that in-house expertise, which is why we can choose them in the first place.
In that case, you mentioned, you said that they have the expertise to carry out this report, but you said earlier in response to your question that we could do the communications better. Is that a failure of the consultants or a self-vote?
No, I don't think it's a failure. We could always do communications better. I believe that we have done as good a job as we could to publicise this review. And maybe this is a question you might want to address to the head of communications, who's got the day-to-day responsibility for comms, and I'm sure Kevin Callan will outline in detail how this review was publicised from the point at which the company were commissioned. But I do believe we've got a very good communications function, and I think it does. I think the staff do a really good job. I don't know if those back requests have been made. Obviously, you weren't the leader then, Ian, so maybe that's a question you should ask to your
board. So I think we're asking you the questions, but
no, but I'm just suggesting I don't know what information the opposition has asked for. That's not in my remit. I'll leave that up to my colleagues on the left here.
Thank you, Councillor Sykes.
The duty to provide a comprehensive and efficient library service under the 64 Act.
And just a quick follow-up question. Do you think there would have been any value in having some consultation with the groups in the initial phases before we ended up adjusting the options?
No, because I think there's still plenty of time for that to happen. So we've got a period of now 3-4 months at which the full business case is going to be worked up. I've already mentioned that there will be an opportunity for this committee to do pre-decision scrutiny. You know, I'm very relaxed about what other events and opportunities are requested. That's very much, you know, and if you've got suggestions, Adam, I'd be really interested to hear them. So I think we've got